Salia yo lea inispo ene lea abomo chenmo khe thugsukula tang ma pa khong sele bomo chenmo la ene khe thugsukula tang lea dukse ya no mo sukula chele ya lea dukse yo ngari bomo chungse a chenmo miska a chile thug ni jole ba jin a chu ta ene balang thi dena sing chu che tini garif chi ke shole yong se balang ma chi re skip pota minu pale ya men no tanga du gozare Kong sang ma yang sil kan song kong song kula thugu tang cha song yang man do panog le. Skit putarak pale yang kong sukula sukul yal ba tang ay zire dika bor banog le. Kong sukula rule ya sukul yal ba zale tang ay zire kherog le.
Dasanya ngata ngade yargias pa nangyampo ngyampo changma ngata sa skula ta ano kalali. Skula ta ngan ngyampo tini dimba na te minguni ka jaspa sa skanto. Yangata ng ngingje sa sjeso. Yangata ng choso tini ngungje sa sino yali. Jeze na mama ngata ng kitab siljes. Mama ng samjes nga doctor gurgo sherak, engineer gurgo sherak halali. Tebo samjes mini te ngata ng sjeso sino ng michig na chiga ngata ng Yato choches nang, roch choches nang, tene de singje choches bo,
Through our kind of cultural myopia, we sort of think that, you know, we educate our kids, we send our kids to school, we have a form of enculturating kids into our society, which is education. And peoples who don't mimic those same patterns of education somehow don't educate their kids. Well, of course, that is absurd.
Today, Western schooling is responsible for introducing a human monoculture across the entire world. Essentially, the same curriculum is being taught, and it's training people for jobs, very scarce jobs, but for jobs in an urban consumer culture. The diversity of cultures, as well as the diversity of unique human individuals, is being destroyed in this way.
Now, this particular school that was established, called the Moravian Mission School, was secular in the sense that, of course, some Christian teaching was given as a part of an evangelistic outreach by the Moravians. In 1887, when the school first started, there were certain perceptions that were wrong. For example, a school started by the missionaries on a street corner must have an ulterior motive of conversion, of teachings that are in conflict with the teachings of the traditional society or the religion.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
And I have been told that the children had to come by force to the school. They wouldn't like to. People just wouldn't send children to the school.
And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us.
I strongly believe that a secular education system and a cosmopolitan school society should not be at the expense of losing Ladakhiness.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. For thy kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
If you have lost your history, you have lost everything.
Oh, my name is Allah.
You know, the great lesson of anthropology is the idea that the world into which you were born doesn't exist in some absolute sense, but is just one model of reality, the consequence of one particular set of adaptive choices that your lineage made, however successfully many generations ago. And the other peoples of the world aren't failed attempts at being you, or in our case, failed attempts at modernity. They are, by definition, unique facets of the human imagination. And when asked the meaning of being human, they respond with 6,000 different voices. And those voices collectively become the human repertoire for dealing with the challenges that will confront us in the ensuing millennia. You know, we always have this this idea of our society as not being really a culture, but being the real world, and these other cultures are outside there. Those are the cultures. But that kind of cultural myopia we really can no longer afford. And, you know, we aren't the real inexorable wave of history. We're just another set of possibilities. We're just another cultural reality with choices that we've made. And that's why in the whole realm of child rearing and education, I think it behooves us to look at models of enculturation, of initiation, of bringing children to the realm of adulthood that other societies have celebrated and developed over thousands of years of experience.
There's no doubt that if we look honestly at the traditional forms of education and compare them to today's modern education system, that the traditional forms of knowledge fostered sustainability. All these cultures were not perfect, but they did know about their own specific climate, soil, water, and they did manage to survive independently in charge of their own lives for generation after generation. In the modern economy and with the modern educational system, the children learn nothing about that, but instead they learn how to use essentially corporate products in an urban consumer culture. So once they've been educated in modern schools, they literally don't know how to survive in their own environment.
Education is not simply the transmission of information. It's by definition the transmission and indeed the enculturation, or one could say more harshly, the indoctrination of a child into a certain way of knowing, a way of learning, a way of being. And again, when we project our notions of what education is or what a way of being is overseas into other people's lives, we forget that we're projecting just something that we made up, right? And one of the things that I see in my work is that different ways of knowing, different ways of being, different ways of learning really create different human beings. If you're raised in Colorado to believe that a mountain is an inert pile of rock waiting to be mined, you're going to have a very different relationship to that mountain from a kid from southern Peru who believes in the fiber of his being that a mountain is an Apu spirit, a protective deity that will direct his destiny throughout life. Now, the interesting observation is not whether that mountain is in fact a spirit or whether it's just a pile of dirt. The interesting observation is how the education system into what that mountain is creates a different human being with a different relationship to the earth. I was raised in the forests of British Columbia to believe that those forests existed to be cut. That was the foundation of the ideology of scientific forestry that I was taught in school and that I practiced as a logger in the woods. It was based on the idea that we had to eliminate all the old growth to get some healthy plantations growing in their wake, because after all, the incremental addition of cellulose would be higher in a plant. I mean, but this was a construct. But critically, that belief system made me a very different human being with a very different relationship to that forest than my friends from native communities who believed that that forest was the abode of Hukuk and the crooked beak of heaven. Because of my ideology, my education, those forests no longer exist. We'll be right back.
I think the way Western education has grown over the last few centuries, especially with the rise of industrialization, was basically not to create human beings fully equipped to deal with life and all its problems, independent citizens able to exercise their decisions and live their responsibilities in community, but elements to feed into an industrial production system. They were products with partial knowledge. We moved from wisdom to knowledge, and now we are moving from knowledge to information, and that information is so partial that we are creating incomplete human beings.
If we look back at the beginning of so-called education, the agenda was very clear. There was an elite that wanted to train people to serve their needs, to essentially create an extractive economy that served the few at the expense of the many. So there's very explicit literature. Very clearly, education was there to train a class of people to serve the needs of the elite.
When Macaulay came to India, I don't know how many of you know, but Macaulay was the guy who created in the minutes of Macaulay, it's called Macaulay's Children. And Macaulay's children, he said, would be brown on the outside but white on the inside. That they would basically know only one thing, how to rule India as if they were Europeans themselves.
Well, if you go back to the 60s and you look at a lot of the modernization literature, so it's very clearly written that local language, local tradition, local customs is a barrier to modernization. And for communities to progress in kind of stages of development, these things need to be eliminated.
99% of all the activities that go under the label of education come from this very specific agenda that grew out of a colonial expansion across the world by Europeans. And now in different countries in the so-called Third World, the basic fundamental agenda is the same, is to pull people into dependence on a modern, centralized economy, is to pull them away from their independence and from their own culture and self-respect.
There's actually a very big global program that is going on right now called Education for All. And it is, every person I've met who is associated with has basically no questions around its agenda or attention, which is very disturbing. It's a program which is sanctioned by every government in the world. It's a program which the World Bank and the UN agencies support. It's a program that corporations are also now, major corporations, McDonald's and many others are also behind. And the agenda of the program is to get every child into school. The claim is that, again, by going to school, communities will be able to develop and they'll be able to become part of the mainstream society. Now, I think we need to question, what does it mean to become part of the mainstream today? And that, for me, is very, very much tied to a very clear agenda of becoming part of the global economy and shifting one's own local economy, one's own local culture, one's own local resources, both personal as well as collective, into the service of the global economy.
So you will find prime ministers and presidents of countries regularly saying, we have got to change our education system to make us more competitive in the global economy. That means we have got to train our young people so that they will suit the needs of giant mobile corporations.
Well, the Education for All initiative is an attempt to redress what was seen as a serious imbalance in funding for primary education. The intent really is to get every child into school. I think we see education as crucial. It's an absolutely necessary condition for sustained poverty reduction. The demand now for education is not just coming from people like the World Bank and outsiders. It's coming from businessmen who are discovering that they can't grow their factories because they can't grow their businesses because there's a shortage of skilled workers. Be very careful about not being paternalistic to so-called ancient cultures. We can help them and certainly not ruin or try to wreck their own cultures. But on the other hand, I think we should be careful about trying to preserve their culture in kind of cold storage. If they don't want that, we should be there to help them. If you tour a tribal area in India and you ask and you sit with a group of women and you say to them, why is education important for your children? I mean, they look at you as if you're completely stupid. I mean, of course it's important for our children. So you say, well, but why? Tell me why. Because we don't want them to live like we live.
When modern Western education is introduced into traditional cultures around the world, it creates a huge sense of inferiority. The school books talk about a Western urban consumer culture as progress, as the only way to be. And the end result is that children end up feeling that their own culture, their language, their way of doing things is backward, primitive and shameful.
I heard from my grandmother that before the women, they used to go. They don't used to go to school. They just stayed in the house, and they went to they went with the cows in the mountains, and they come back in the evening, and they make food and other things.
One of the things I've seen that education has really created is a sense of inferiority at many levels. One at the level of elders. I've visited many villages wanting to learn from elders and kinds of traditional practices, and the first response is always, I don't know anything, go and talk to my son, he's a 10th class pass, or he's a 12th grade pass, or whatever, and I don't know anything, I don't understand anything. And so that is always probably in my life, that has been one of the most painful things I've heard over and over in villages.
Yuntan zhkanbo djes nang silches po yuntan ino deni I jingbari laspo mane yuntan digmane toksik chor ma chor pa sangne deni amale un ngaja nang yampo dozdur chyo sana tenna bo amale un zeduk ngaja mane yuntan met ngaja chang sesa met zeduk.
There's a widely held belief today that it is through modern education that we're going to raise people out of poverty. But if we look honestly at what's been happening, we'll see that it's the advent of colonialism, development and aid that have created poverty. In the pre-modern or pre-development systems and economies, you will not find the kind of poverty that you do in the modern slums of Calcutta and Mexico City, Beijing. Today, in most traditional villages, whether it be in China, India, or Africa, people are led to believe that the future is this modern urban consumer culture. And they are going into debt. They are selling their houses to give their child an education. The great hope is that they're going to get a good job as an engineer, as a doctor in the modern economy. Less than 10% are succeeding. 90% end up failures. They might get a job as a servant or as a car mechanic, but it is not the glorious life that people had hoped for.
Most of the students of Ladakh, they don't do very well. Amongst 10, 2 will be good, more than good. But about the 8, they won't be better.
Dene gormeni last ni thop ma thop pasane dene thugu sangwa pat mane sembas pomet kanle dene thugu sangwa mane pat the sonjan thos bisele.
One of the things is most disturbing to me at a level of actually justice and morality is that you have an institution that is in place globally that is branding millions and millions and millions of innocent people as failures. very brilliant, wonderful, talented kinds of people are always introducing themselves in India to me. Oh, I'm a 8th class fail, or I'm a 10th class fail. That's their introduction. What's amazing is that, you know, people who are claiming to be concerned with social justice cannot see the huge kind of social hierarchy and inequity that is created through education, modern education. It's mind-boggling for me how people don't see that. The other thing is a loss in terms of the kind of richness of imagination and cultural resources that people could bring, because I think those who are branded as failures actually have a wide variety of capacity to think in different ways. And that is all being suppressed and lost. And so people who can only think in a very fragmented, you know, one-dimensional kind of way, those people are getting rewarded. Anybody who claims to be concerned with social justice need to have a serious conversation around that.
I come from the central Himalayan region, which is called Garhwal. And the women of Garhwal worked very hard to make sure their kids would have schooling. But of course, the schooling was the institutionalized schooling of the kind that doesn't teach you anything about your local ecology, your local culture, your local economy, or your ability to be productive. It basically teaches you to be a semi-literate for another system to which you have no entry, because you don't belong to the right class, you don't belong to the right privilege, etc. I now go back to those same villages, and the women said the worst mistake they made was to think that kind of education would help. That we have a saying in Hindi, "Dhobi ka kutta na ghar ka na ghat ka," that, you know, it's the washerman's dog who belongs neither to the place where the washing is done nor to the home. That they're in between people, and they're falling through the cracks of an in-between world.
Sad to see how many Westerners come out to remote, relatively sustainable, relatively intact economies and cultures and fall in love with the place. They want to stay, they want to come back, they love the people, they find the people incredibly happy, incredibly kind, incredibly helpful. And then they want to help develop, bring in Western schooling to improve the lives of these people.
Well, my name is Heidi. I come from Germany, from the southern part, that's Bavaria. And as I live in Bavaria, I'm keen on mountaineering. And that was the reason why, of course, I wanted to go to the Himalayas. And as I was a teacher, I was teaching English, German, ethics, that's a kind of religion. I was interested in schools, and so I happened to meet Lambden School here. And of course, I got so much from the people here, from their religious belief, from their mentality, the way of compassion, tolerance, that I thought, well, I must do something for this school. Step by step, I tried to find sponsors, I tried to collect money. For instance, I'm proud, over there is a hostel, a girls' hostel for 100 pupils, And this is mainly done, built by the money I could collect.
Here is a list of possible reasons why one uses a mirror. First, to check one's appearance. To check one's appearance. Do you do that?
Yeah.
Mirror for checking. And to look beautiful. To check appearance, yes, you check appearance. Check appearance, not only to see how you look, but also how you are dressed up, okay? Right? How you are dressed up. So you look good, okay? Right. And then to look beautiful. How much important is it? Vanity. Beauty. Everybody cares for their looks, okay? Like everybody cares for the looks, you know, how you look, right? How you look. It's very important.
Even if they stay here for 1 or 2 years, and sometimes they have to go back, forced by their parents to work in the fields, to look after younger children, they gain something for their life. Some go to military forces, then they are good tradesmen, they open shops and sell all those necklaces and sweaters and these things. Or they learn special jobs, and now mainly, as I know and as I hope, in computer techniques. So they go to India and have a good chance. So I think they have overcome real poverty here. And some people say, well, why don't you go to Congo or so? But I think they still need help. It's not only to throw them into the water and then let them swim. They need everything, from clothing to mental aid.
For if we are to fit and train such children for the future, they cannot be left as they are. And in spite of himself, the native must be helped.
I look at the number of really well-intentioned people who are trying to help other people with this package of schooling and aid. I really don't think that there's any bad intention behind that. I think it's purely out of good-heartedness and a will to help other people. It's just that they don't connect the dots. They don't often stay long enough to really look at the overall impact. And they simply don't look broadly enough.
I did my schooling from Moravan Mission School, which is in Leh, which I think is the best school of Ladakh.
Starting, I was there in Lamdon Model School, Leh, until sixth class. I did my higher secondary school in Delhi itself. I've been in Delhi from the past 8-9 years.
When I was at the age, when I did my first class, then I was shifted out here. I shifted out here in Mussoorie, then Dehradun, and then Delhi.
I don't know about my culture very much. We are not really much aware about our tradition and all.
Basically, when students come to Delhi to study, so they're exposed to an environment which is very different from Ladakh. And they tend to forget their own culture. Sometimes they don't even know how to speak their own language. They forget their traditions, and I think which is not a good sign for Ladakh.
Nobody speaks the fluent Ladakhi, which was origin before.
But we are here and follow the global traditions, or we are trying to be, we are trying to compete with them.
We just after money.
You know, the year that you were born, there were 6,000 languages spoken on Earth. Now, a language isn't just grammar or vocabulary. A language is a flash of the human spirit. It's a vehicle through which the soul of every culture comes in the world. Every language, I've always said, is like a old-growth forest of the mind, an ecosystem of thought, a watershed of social and spiritual possibilities. As we sit here, half those languages are not being taught to children.
In some areas where we are very strict, for example, speaking in English.
My school is English medium school, and every children are speaking in English, and when they are in the playground also they speak in English.
In class,
yeah, in class also, everywhere. In the school, we have to speak in English.
We are strict that the children speak in English with the teachers in the class and with each other.
Yeah, if somebody speak the other Ladakhi or Hindi, and then teacher give him or her punished, yeah.
What happens when somebody gets punished?
Yeah, it's get the money. Yeah, it's fine money. 5 rupees.
But that discipline inculcates a habit of English. And English is one language that commands the world today. Be it the cyber world, internet, anything, business, you have got to learn English in India.
When we go to other countries, it's we have to speak in English. We don't have English speaking, we can't go to other country and speaking. Yeah. It's English speaking is very good. And when I graduate, I will go to other countries, any country.
What, where do you think you'll go to study?
In Delhi.
Will your mom miss you when you move to Delhi?
Yeah, I will miss her. Miss my mom.
I miss my hometown, really. And my parents, because I've been here, not here properly, but out of to my town, about 10 or 12 years. And about a place called Ladakh, you've seen. It's a heaven, really it is heaven, okay? I miss Ladakh too much, because home is home, right?
The great tragedies of schooling is how it has ripped people out from nature and locked them up into rooms for 8 hours a day. And I think the profound kind of damage that it's doing to us, only we'll recognize generations from now, and then we'll look back and say, how could we have done this kind of thing to people? And thinking that, you know, creating concrete, you know, jails and locking people up into that and giving them books that tell them about nature is a better way to think about life than actually spending time in nature.
Why it is given this name? Can you tell me? Do you have any idea why we call this name? The spelling is xerophytic. It's xerophytic. Why do we call this name? Xerophytic vegetation. The type of vegetation that we have here in Ladakh is xerophytic. Now, can you cite me the reason why we call this type of vegetation as xerophytic vegetation? Anyone in the class?
Anyone? Anyone?
Do we have heavy rainfall here? No, we have scanty rainfall here. So for that reason, we as we have discussed, have, you know, forest, good forest. We can't expect to have great vegetation here. And we are here, I just wanted to add that with the distinct type of plants, animals, and the environment, human is also included in the ecosystem. Understand? Now, how is human included? Why do we say that human is an integral part in the ecosystem? How do you think that human are involved in the ecosystem? Anyone in the class?
Anyone? Anyone?
Tene tezam shik zerang maze bano nyanang mayan pasane garung sa kozak chustang pasane ngata environment bo tene te chu te sanga chulung po sanga stopo jan ngal sakyat po ama khor ama tok shinol chenel bub nasa sendel sakyat po khorang bo ngata beng tok shinol ngal tene chung basane ngata di sakyat po zeskan bo ngata phache na pura mirap na mirap ngata bor ngen che sakyat chin ngal yontan jena po pe na ngach che yontan ji yoto nge yontan bo tok khuri nge thugo tang ngen chiz man ngen
And the amazing thing, if you think about it, is that biologists have finally proven it to be true what philosophers have always dreamt to be true, which is the fact that we're all brothers and sisters. We are all, by definition, cut from the same genetic cloth. That means that all human populations, all cultures, in general, share the same raw mental capacity, intellectual capacity, mental acuity, whatever. And what that means is that whether a people place their genius into technological innovation, as has been the tradition in the West, or by contrast, into, in the case of the Tibetan Buddhists, into spending 2,500 years trying to understand the nature of existence in what we call always a science of the mind. And why do we use the word science? Because what is science but the pursuit of the truth? And what is Buddhism but the empirical pursuit of the truth? As Matthieu Ricard, a Tibetan monk, former molecular biologist at the Pasteur Institute in Paris, always says that Western science is a major response to minor needs. We spend all of our lives trying to make sure that we live to be 100 without losing our teeth or our hair. And in Tibet, people spend their lives trying to understand the nature of existence. He says all of our billboards advertise naked young children in underwear. Their billboards, which are mani walls, are engravings in stone of prayers for the well-being of all sentient beings.
One of the things that's always quite surprising to me is people's understanding of Gandhi. All over the world, people claim to be big fans of Gandhi, and if you actually start to look at what the man wrote, he was extremely, extremely critical of modern education, and particularly Western knowledge. That was something that Gandhi was
was openly questioning what is the great contribution of Western knowledge actually to the well-being of life on the planet. And so people misunderstood that, you know, they thought that Gandhi was against the British. And actually he said, I have no problem with the British, but they need to understand that these systems that have been created over all over the world are fundamentally disempowering, dehumanizing, destructive, not only to human beings, to all life on the planet, and they cannot sustain themselves. He said this in 1909. And he said, we're not just trying to get rid of the British and keep their systems. He used a very nice phrase. He said, this freedom struggle is not about getting rid of the tiger, but keeping the tiger's nature.
And, you know, we don't think of ourselves as a culture. Therefore, when we export something like our economic model, we don't see it as what it is, which is just one option, one way of organizing economic behavior. And yet, when you think about it, all the indices of the development paradigm say almost nothing about quality of life. People talk about per capita income quadrupling. Well, what does that mean? It might mean that some farmer has gone from a non-cash agrarian economy into a sweatshop in a slum in Delhi. Is his quality of life gone up because his income's quadrupled? I mean, that's another part of our kind of cultural myopia. We put out this idea, which I think is a blatant lie, that if people buy into the dictates of our economic paradigm, that somehow they will magically achieve the wealth that we enjoy in the West. Ain't gonna happen. Just on energy resources alone, it would take four planet Earths to bring the whole global population to our level of consumption. So, you know, we project this world view overseas with this illusion that if people buy into it, they'll achieve what we have. And then you have to back up and say, well, what is it that we have that makes us so spectacular? Many wondrous things. I mean, believe me, if I get in a car accident and my arm's cut off, I don't want to be taken to an African herbalist. I want to be taken to an emergency room. I'm not knocking our culture. But on the other hand, you look at the way we make money, the way we earn our daily bread, is based on an economic paradigm that by any scientific definition is changing the biochemistry of the biosphere. This is not trivial, and it certainly doesn't suggest that our way of life is a paragon of humanity's potential.
The way for cultures to survive in today's world is not by isolating themselves and cutting themselves off. In fact, I believe that more than ever we need a deeper dialogue between the West and the non-industrialized parts of the world. We need that dialogue because the media and conventional education is perpetuating a lie, basically, about a way to succeed and how we can all attain this glorious, wealthy, luxurious lifestyle. We urgently need to sit down and talk to each other and communicate the fact that this model isn't even working in America, which is the center of this dream.
And it's really important that as we think of different cultures, you know, there's this sort of idea that these other peoples, you know, quaint and colorful though they may be, are somehow destined to fade away as the real world, our world, moves on. Nothing could be further from the truth. These cultures are not frail and fragile. On the contrary, they're dynamic, living peoples being driven out of existence by identifiable forces. Why is that so important? It's important because culture is not trivial. You know, culture is not decorative. It's not feathers and bells. It's not dances. It's not even ritual. Culture is a blanket of moral and ethical values that we insulate the individual with. And if you want to know what happens when culture is lost, and yet the individual survives, a shadow of their former selves, unable to go back to the comfort of tradition and roots, but cast adrift into an alien world where generally the destination is simply the lowest rung on the economic ladder that goes nowhere, you just have to look at the seas of misery that are the demographic centers of the third world. There have been many cases in history where overt acts of the violation of human rights, dislocation of peoples, have been absolutely motivated by economic and political interests of elites and of vested power structures, no question about it. I think in a strange sense, the greater threats have come about through the good intentions of those who don't understand that those good intentions may not be appropriate and may reflect just, a projection of our own ideologies. If someone goes to another culture and says, I'm here to educate your children, I mean, that's one of the most outrageous and audacious things you can ever imagine. If you go to that culture and say, we've got some skills that you probably could use. To me, that's the sharing of information that should be both reciprocal and honored. But it's very different for me to go and say, your ways are no longer acceptable. You know, get with the program, educate your kids in this school, get rid of your superstitious ideas, and accept some of mine.
There is an assumption that Western education, Western knowledge is universally applicable, is something that is superior. There's a sense that we have evolved to a higher level of being, and that these people, however lovely they are, they're going to benefit from this superior knowledge.
The saddest state of this is of the NGOs, who think that they are actually going in and helping communities by helping them lose their languages and helping them lose their self-sufficiency, and helping them, tying them into the global economy and getting them more cash, which ultimately leads to them having less control over their own lives. A lot of them are very well-intentioned, good people who are actually thinking they're doing something good for children and for communities, but they don't understand, I think, the much larger game in which they are pawns.
The bottom line is, we're living through a time of transition that it just behooves us to pay attention to. It's like what Margaret Mead said before she died. Her greatest fear was that as we drifted blindly toward this blandly amorphous generic world, whatever it's going to be, We would wake one day as from a dream, having forgotten that there were even other possibilities of life itself. You know? These peoples, these visions, aren't failed attempts at being us. They're unique answers to the fundamental question, what does it mean to be human and alive? And many of those peoples, when they answer that question, they answer it in ways that have allowed them to live sustainably on the planet for, by definition, generations. The species has been around for a long time. Who knows when you want to say it began as a social form, 150,000 years ago? The Neolithic Revolution that gave us agriculture, that's only 10,000 years ago. Modern industrial society, as we know it, is scarcely 300 years old. That shouldn't suggest that we have all of the answers for all of the challenges that are going to confront us as a species in the ensuing millennia.
Little boxes on the hillside, little boxes made of ticky-tacky, little boxes on the hillside, little boxes all the same. There's a pink one and a green one and a blue one and a yellow one, and they're all made out of ticky-tacky, and they all look just the same. And the people in the houses all went to the university, where they were put in boxes and they came out all the same. And there's doctors and lawyers and business executives, and they're all made out of ticky-tacky, and they all look just the same. And they all play on the golf course and drink their martinis dry, and they all have pretty children, and the children go to school, and the children go to summer camp, and then to the university, where they are put in boxes and they come out all the same. And the boys go into business and marry and raise a family in boxes made of ticky-tacky, and they all look just the same. There's a pink one and a green one and a blue one and a yellow one, and they're all made out of ticky-tacky, and they all look just the same.
Yeah, Julie.